please join me in welcoming Alexei for his talk, New Materials Made Under Pressure from Prediction to Discovery.
Well, I really appreciate the invitation. Can you hear me well? Right. So it's a really great opportunity to share some of my experience and talk more about different aspects of materials discovery with groups here. And in fact, this institute really reminds me of Kapitsa Institute for Physical Problems in Moscow. It's really just this old feeling, some sort of ancient library with old books. So it's traditional here in these talks to go 20 years back and mention that 20 years ago it was considered practically impossible to predict crystal structures from first principles. Quite a lot has changed from this, and but still there are jokes regarding the role of predictive work. So it's difficult to make predictions, especially about the future, so you can insert either crystal structures or superconductors here. Well, we have made some progress, and I'd like to give my perspective what we can do and still cannot. I will begin by overviewing general structure prediction strategies and show a few examples of prediction validation. So these compounds or phases were synthesized under pressure, and calcium B6 has this really interesting boron framework, and iron B4 unexpectedly turned out to be a phonon-mediated superconductor, and we developed it fully from scratch. And then I will mention a couple of standing predictions in the family of tin-based materials. So sodium tin 2 seems to be a really interesting sort of analog to graphene, and barium tin 2 appears to be an overlooked strong topological insulator. If time allows, I will say a few words about how we plan to accelerate our structure search with neural network-based interatomic models, but probably I won't have time for it. So, what does it take to predict a synthesizable material? Well, the vast majority of materials that form are thermodynamically stable, at least for if you consider crystalline bulk materials. So, what it means for us is that we need to find global minima in a large configuration space of structures and compositions. So you need to visit all relevant minima, and you need to be able to resolve the energies of these competing structures. So in terms of what methods you can use to evaluate the energy of the structures, there is a wide variety of methods. On the left-hand side, you have accurate quantum chemistry and quantum Monte Carlo methods, but they're not still practical for large systems. On the right-hand side, you basically get rid of electronic degrees of freedoms and arrive at classical potentials, and you lose some accuracy. But these models are significantly faster, so you can deal with much larger unit cells. Well, DFT seems to be currently a right balance between accuracy and efficiency. And in fact, if you're interested in how reliable predictions are based on DFT, Stefano Cortarolo's group at Duke and my group have done extensive studies and comparisons between DFT and experiment. And for metal-metal alloys, the agreement was 97%. For more complicated metal-boron compounds, the agreement was 83%. But I have to say that we went through hundreds of published experimental results, and not all of these discrepancies are due to DFT. Right. So I'd like to just mention what it takes to establish whether your minimum is a global minimum or not. So let's say that you are basing your estimations of energies on DFT. So this is a simple example of a diamond ring, and let's consider the carbon first, because it's a fixed composition, so all you need to do is just to select competing structures at given pressure and temperature conditions and estimate their Gibbs energy. So if you're lucky, you will find the global minimum, but even if you find metastable states at some pressure and temperature, they might become thermodynamically stable minima at other pressure and temperature conditions. things are far more complicated if you deal with multi-component materials, because in this case, you don't even know at which composition you will have a stable compound or not. So in this case, first you need to establish what is the most stable elemental crystal structure. In this case, it would be FCC gold and FCC copper. So you now reference your energy with respect to the energy of these two elemental ground states. And let's say that you mixed four parts of gold and one part of copper, and you considered some crystal structure, and you reference the energy again to this ground states. So you calculate the formation energy, and if it happens to be positive, it means that this compound will be unstable because the energy of the system can be lowered if it just decomposes into the elements, so that the energy will be lowered. So a necessary condition for a compound to be thermodynamically stable is for the formation energy to be negative. Well, it's a necessary but not sufficient condition, because let's say that you found the structure here. It does have a negative formation energy, but as you can imagine, it can decompose into this stable compound and this elemental copper, and then the energy will be lowered. So this compound is at best metastable. So in order to predict a new thermodynamically stable compound, you need to find something that is below the line that connects all known stable compounds. And that's basically the purpose of our structure search, to identify stable compounds that are below these tie lines. Typically, it looks like this. You have a lot of tries that are not successful. And in fact, the best you can hope for is finding a compound that is close to the tie line. Point being is that most binary systems have been explored already, so it's very unlikely to find something new that hasn't been observed experimentally. But if you happen to find something close to the tie line, you might adjust temperature or pressure conditions and have it synthesized under those conditions. So let's say that you have identified a composition where you expect something to form. So how do you actually find the most stable structure? So there are quite a few strategies that I broadly divide into constrained search, unconstrained search, and rational design. So in this constrained search, or so-called high-throughput screening, you rely on nature's tendency to repeat stable motifs. So effectively, you take a library of already observed crystal structures and just do chemical substitutions. Because you retain symmetry, you can actually explore quite a few possibilities. In fact, there are two large projects, materials projects at Berkeley and the AFLOLIB consortium at Duke, that have considered hundreds of thousands of entries and looked at millions of properties already. Well, this is a very effective way, but the drawback here is that if your structure has not been observed before, you will overlook it. So for that, you need unconstrained search when you don't assume any symmetry. And there is a variety of methods how you could construct the most stable configuration. So let's say one way is just to do a random search when you generate random structures and relax them to the local minimum. So you just take them down. And this is a fairly good approach because there is no bias. You just generate absolutely random structures and relax them locally. Unfortunately, for large structures, this method doesn't work very well. So a typical approach is to try to get these structures out of local minima. And this would be done, let's say, in a Monte Carlo type optimization. But as I will show you in a second, this method also doesn't work that well for large systems. And the reason is because you really need to overcome these large barriers that chemically correspond to breaking bonds. And it's not so easy to distort your structure in such a way that you actually break bonds. So a fairly efficient way of overcoming these barriers is to do an evolutionary search. The basic idea here is that you generate a population of structures, let's say two in our case. And then when you create your next try, you take two parent structures and basically combine two halves from them to create an offspring. So this way you cut through bonds and you might be lucky and end up in the right valley. And then you just do a local optimization and hopefully you'll get to the ground state. Well, actually my favorite method is rational design, and that involves just prolonged staring at crystal structures and investigating trends. So in some cases you might spot that, well, you get better and better minimum if you adjust, let's say, the size of the element, and then you might guess that there is a better minimum somewhere. So in fact, it's hard to predict, well, hard to say which method led you to a particular prediction, because usually it's a combination of three. So in terms of high throughput search, we examined this family of metal borides. I believe we created the largest ab initio database for them. We investigated over 12,000 compounds. I've developed this evolutionary search package. And in terms of rational design, we rely on this investigation of trends. And we have been successful in a few cases. So in fact, in this map, I'm trying to show what combination of methods led to a particular prediction. So in gray, we have standing predictions. In red, confirmed predictions. And let's say in this case of calcium B6, my first example, the majority of our work was done with the evolutionary approach. But then we were able to refine this structure a little bit using some rational design. The second example will concern iron B4. And we arrived at this composition by doing high throughput search. And then we proposed a better crystal structure using the evolutionary approach. And I wish I had more time, but it really takes about half an hour to explain our most complicated example, lithium boron. In fact, that was my first prediction in 2006, but it took almost a decade to confirm it. In fact, there was an experiment that was done very thoroughly, but they didn't observe that particular phase. It's complicated because there is some shift in composition depending on the pressure. The phase is fairly disordered, so it took a while. The reason we find it really exciting that we observed it is that because it's supposed to be the closest analog to magnesium diboride superconductor. We didn't manage to measure the superconductivity, but we showed that this phase remains metastable at ambient pressure. So if you're able to retrieve it, hopefully you can show that it is a good superconductor. Okay, so perhaps I could just say a few more words about the evolutionary search. So this is a standard procedure that we start with completely random structures. What that means is that we generate three random vectors, and we put random atoms in that box. Obviously, you need to make sure that the atoms aren't too close to each other, so I wrote some algorithm to achieve that. So once you created these, you relax them locally, just to the closest minimum. The generation of a next population works like this. You pick a couple of parents randomly, and you slice them approximately in half. Then they put these two halves together, hoping that this child will inherit some beneficial stable motifs from the parents. There is a lot of machinery involved how to make it work, so it took me actually quite some time to figure it out, but now this procedure is fairly stable. So that's the way you generate a new population, either with this so-called crossover operation, when you take two parents, or mutation operations, when you just take one parent and distort the structure or swap some elements. So then you relax these guys locally and mix them with the population of the parents. So now there is time for natural selection. And you basically assign fitness in terms of their enthalpy. So the more stable it is, the more chance it has to survive. What is really critical is not to just take the most stable ones, because such a procedure will likely converge to the same structure. So in evolutionary terms, it's called stagnation. So you actually prefer to just have some randomness in the selection process, and you need to keep these high energy structures in the population so you can explore a larger part of the configurational space. So this is the way you create a new population and you proceed. So this is a typical energy profile as you evolve the population. So you start with fairly bad guesses, and then you keep your best member in the population, but you allow the rest to be naturally selected. What is very important is to maintain diversity in your population. So it does make sense to keep 10 copies of your best structure. So again, for that purpose, I had to develop a method back in 2006 or 8 actually, to distinguish structures based on only their local environments. So that turned out to be a fairly effective way, and as you can see here, we maintain a fairly good diversity throughout this evolution. Okay, so let me show you the first example. The reason I originally looked at metal borides is because there was a big discovery of superconductivity in magnesium diboride. And we looked particularly at this calcium-boron system because calcium is also divalent. But ultimately, we focused on calcium B6 composition because we realized that there are really interesting complex phases appearing in there under pressure. So in fact, there are quite a few metals that form metal hexaboride structure. And at the time when we were writing this paper, there was only one structure characterized at this composition, this cubic CP7 structure. This is really unusual because boron forms really a large diversity of structures. And these materials are known to be very good thermionic emitters, superconductors, and lately I think even some interesting topological properties have been observed in this family. So my first test was just to see if we squeeze the structure, can we have any more stable configurations? And this is a case of a unit cell with 14 atoms. Let's see this only will quickly play. So what happens is that you start with this cubic structure. It's just a 2-1-1 supercell. And under pressure, oops, no, it didn't play. Yes. So it basically rearranges. Oops, right. And forms this peculiar units. I think they're called twinned pentagonal white pyramids. So it's a good indication that something interesting will happen. Some transition has to happen. But we don't know exactly which structure will be the ground state. That was just our first guess. Moreover, we looked at the dynamical stability of this original structure. And by dynamical stability, I mean your symmetry can be spontaneously broken if you apply pressure and some imaginary modes some phonon modes become imaginary. So in this case, a phonon mode would correspond to this doubled unit cell in each direction, and the imaginary mode tilts this octahedra. So if you look at the dependence of this frequency mode on pressure, you see that we start with a positive frequency, and then it becomes imaginary at some pressure. And in order to understand why it becomes imaginary, I simulated all divalent hexaborides. And as you can see here, the size really matters, because if you put barium inside this framework, it keeps this framework stable or inflated up to very large pressures. Well, calcium is not that large, so at some point this network wobbles. And magnesium and beryllium are so small that this structure wouldn't be dynamically stable even under ambient pressure. Right, so if you look at what happens to the enthalpy with respect to the enthalpy of the original ambient pressure phase, then we gain a little bit due to dynamical instability. Or if you manage to achieve rebonding, you will gain quite a bit of enthalpy. So that was our state of prediction when I approached a group of Andrew Jeffcoat at Oxford, and he liked the idea to try it, and he suggested me to apply for synchrotron time, so I managed to get it. So he loaded the sample, and at the time of the experiment, we showed up just intending to watch what's happening, and he said, well, I don't have anybody. So this is the diamond anvil cell, this is synchrotron. So it was my colleague, my student, all computational physicists. So we ended up doing all the experiment. Well, I'm proud to say that we didn't break anything. In fact, we've done five more experiments since then, and we've synthesized two new materials. Right, so the majority of you know what that involves. For a computational person, actually the most annoying part was masking these images. We've done hundreds and hundreds of those. But it was really, I think, beneficial for this discovery process that modeling people were directly involved, because during the collection time, we actually fitted these peaks, and we saw, and we even ran some evolution researches to see if these peaks can be fitted to anything. And we focused on particular pressures when we saw some interesting results. And I think that's how we managed to observe this lithium boron that I mentioned at the beginning. So what exactly did we observe in the case of calcium boron? So when we first squeezed it at room temperature, the structure remained essentially the same. So here in cyan, you see calcium B6 in this cubic phase. There was some strange suppression of one peak, but essentially it was the same morphology. So then we laser heated the sample at 34 and then 44 GPa, and finally we saw some first evidence that this CP7 structure is destroyed. Well, beware what you wish for, because I ended up spending about a few months staring at this pattern and trying to understand what it meant. I tried to index these peaks, and we just couldn't extract any information from the experiment. So I tried all my metastable states that I generated with the evolution research, but I couldn't match anything. So ultimately, I doubled the unit cell and ran my evolution research at 28 atoms. And after quite a while, one morning, I discovered a huge drop in enthalpy, so the structure basically collapsed. And that was the beautiful new configuration that has this boron block consisting of 24 atoms. And when we checked the XRD pattern, it finally became clear why it was so difficult to solve the original pattern, because apparently there are two phases at the same composition that coexisted. So this set of peaks is present in the experimental pattern, but there are some additional peaks that we couldn't still resolve. We were quite convinced that this is the phase, because when we looked at the pattern generated at higher pressures, now you have a lot more, I would say, a higher pressure, higher fraction of this high pressure phase. So this was a really nice benchmark test for different methods of predicting crystal structures. So after we actually identified this with the evolution research, we ran additional tests trying to see how other methods fare. So let's first look at this test when we didn't do this crossover operation, when you mix two halves of two structures. And we started with random configurations. But we did distort the structure, so it's a sort of Monte Carlo type optimization. So this set of magenta points remained very high. So for 28 atoms, it's really difficult for this method to find anything meaningful. We didn't even find the original structure with seven atoms that we should have, since we considered 28 atoms. For comparison, when we ran evolution research, then we found a lot of structures way below this ambient pressure phase. At 50 GPa, we also tried initializing our search not with random structures, but with supercells of this original CP7 cubic phase. And then, indeed, we had a much easier time finding not only these low enthalpy structures with the evolutionary search, but even with local optimizations. So in other words, this phase is structurally connected to this one, but you still need to pick up the proper supercell to construct this one. So the numbers in gray here actually indicate what fraction of 10,000 tries that we attempted converged to this particular structure. And we were lucky that this tetragonal phase was actually seen once. But once out of 10,000, it's a really small number. You might not be that lucky. So what I've learned from this set of tests is that seeding search with known structure can really speed up the identification of the ground state. Monte Carlo type optimization, surprisingly, is not that effective for large structures. But using evolutionary search, you can really get to a very complex phase. OK, so now let me show you a different example from the field of superconductivity. So it's traditional to show the progress in this field by plotting the critical temperature as a function of time. And there was a steady progress in critical temperature since the discovery of superconductivity in 1911. So the highest was about 25, 30. And when I was in high school, there was a growing consensus that this is it. This is the fundamental level limit. Well, then there was a discovery of unconventional superconductivity in the family of oxides. There was a remarkable discovery of superconductivity in a known magnesium diboride that is conventional. Then there was this iron age when iron-based materials were shown to be superconductors with unconventional pairing mechanism. So now it's more or less understood that this is due to spin fluctuations. And the most recent impressive example is the discovery of superconductivity in compressed hydrogen sulfide. And the record now is over 200 Kelvin. Well, unfortunately, these materials are not practical. This one exists only at a few hundred GPa. And oxides are very brittle. So still, if you look at, let's say, what is used in the Large Hadron Collider, it's the old school superconductors based on niobium or titanium tin. So the way we actually found this potential superconductor was, of course, accidental. We looked at the iron-boron system because we were interested in finding hard materials. So there are a couple of known iron-boron and iron-2-boron compounds, and they're used as hardening agent in steels or hard coatings. So when we did our high-throughput screening, we found that quite a few phases here were very close to the tie line. And I have to say that is really unusual. Typically, you just don't find that at all. So I got intrigued, and I ran an evolutionary search at a number of compositions here. And at 2-to-1 and 4-to-1 compositions, the evolutionary search found two really interesting configurations. One of them is this structure with linear chains. That's really unusual because all metal diboride structures have either planes or buckled planes. So this one actually is predicted to be a semiconductor, which is also very unusual. And we have a lot of stability gain when you form these chains. And this compound hasn't been seen still. Iron B4 is also curious. And we realized that it's close to a known so-called chromium B4 prototype. So once we identified this structure, we also looked at chromium B4. And we realized that this structure is dynamically unstable. This is really bizarre because it has been in around in the literature for over 40 years. And it was a very reasonable solution for a powder XRD pattern. But as we showed, in fact, this structure doesn't exist because it undergoes a significant distortion So, in fact, I've just noticed a review in Advanced Materials, and unfortunately, they still list this structure. Well, once we made this prediction that chromium B4 should also be stable in this particular one, my colleagues in China did an experiment and showed that indeed the proper configuration is this distorted framework. I know that there is also a single crystal study showing that this is the crystal structure. So why do we care so much about the particular crystal structure? Well, superconducting properties are exceptionally sensitive to the crystal structure parameters. So for chromium B4, it doesn't make that much of a difference. You have fairly similar density of states profiles. But for iron B4, you see that there is very low density of states in this dynamically unstable structure. And surprisingly, you see that Fermi level catches this large dose peak. And this is very unusual. Typically, when you have a distortion, it's the other way around. You have a high density of states at the Fermi level, and the way to deal with it, because it's not really a stable configuration, the structure distorts. So because we had such a large density of states, I suggested that my student tries a calculation of the electron-phonon coupling. But again, I didn't expect much because it's an iron-based material. And she came back to me and said, well, it should be a superconductor with a ITC of 15 to 20 Kelvin. That's fairly high for this class of materials. Well, it sounded really bizarre, so we spent quite a bit of time double-checking the results. And apparently, it should be a phonon-mediated superconductor because the magnetism here is suppressed. So effectively, you can think of this boron network as an effective pressure. So it puts these iron atoms closer together, and that results in the decrease in the magnetic interactions. So it's actually non-magnetic. But one should be careful regarding the prediction of superconductivity here, because if you happen to have some impurities, or the structure is distorted a little bit more, you might move this Fermi peak away from the Fermi level. And we estimated then the critical temperature would drop by several orders of magnitude. So that's why we were fairly cautious about how we predicted it. And now the question is, can you synthesize it? And actually, why haven't anybody seen this? Well, we first thought that maybe DFT approximations just gave us an artificial ground state. But we checked a range of DFT approximations, and in all of them, these two structures were stable. So then we showed in a follow-up paper that both iron B4 and iron B2 should stabilize under pressure. And once we published the paper, I spent a couple of years just chasing different experimental groups. Just, can you try it? So we've had the shockwave experiments in Russia. They started with iron and boron, but synthesized only the known iron boron. There was a group in Germany trying to do thin film deposition. They didn't observe this one either. And there was a group at Oxford that tried synthesis of iron B4 under a few GPA, but that wasn't enough. So finally, I just suggested this to a group of Natalia and Leonid Dubrovinsky at Bayreuth, and they kind of disappeared for a year. So it turns out that they were busy the whole year. They just wouldn't give up, and they did synthesize this compound in the exact predicted structure. They also did the superconductivity measurements, and they showed that indeed there is a transition at about 3 Kelvin. So 3 Kelvin doesn't sound like much, but in fact, we were super excited because, again, if you just go away from this peak, you drop the TC down to microkelvin. So apparently, we did catch this peak. So then I suggested that they try synthesis of an isotope. And they showed that the critical temperature does move, which means that this is a conventional phonon-mediated coupling mechanism. So indeed, in terms of predictions, that was a stable compound that remained metastable under ambient conditions. It has the new crystal structure, and it does have this phonon-mediated superconductivity. Well, there are quite a few still questions remaining. For example, we don't know whether it could be synthesized under ambient pressure, even though according to calculations it might be. We don't understand why the distortion leads to a higher density of states at the Fermi level. And well, we have some idea why BTC is lower, just because you're right on the shoulder of this peak. Still, it's an open question. I know there was another follow-up study that synthesized iron before, but they didn't observe any superconductivity there. It's really sensitive to your sample. Okay, so now I'd like to show you a couple of standing predictions. So in this case, I will show you results for tin-based materials. And they're interesting because tin is actually in this group 4 column in the periodic table. So there is a lot of research on low-dimensional structures. And if you move down the periodic table, you will see that carbon has been shown to form graphene. Later on, there was cerisine, germanine, and lately stannine synthesized. But these structures don't form that happily. You need to deposit them on the substrate, and they tend to buckle. So the reason you would like to synthesize this stannine is because you increase spin-orbit coupling interactions, and these materials might become topological insulators. So when we looked at how the original graphene was synthesized, it was exfoliation of graphite. So we thought, are there any stable three-dimensional compounds that you could exfoliate into two-dimensional stannine sheets? And we investigated quite a few known and hypothetical materials just to understand how you could construct such a compound. There are two known stable forms of tin, alpha tin and beta tin. Alpha is basically the diamond structure, and beta tin is a metallic structure. So if you attempt to create just an isolated flat sheet, it's very unstable. You can gain a little bit of stability by allowing it to buckle, but still you're over 0.4 EV per atom above stability. That's a lot. So it really helps to stack these layers up into a three-dimensional framework. And the reason you gain so much stability is because you actually form covalent bonds between atoms in different layers. That's what is different from the case of carbon, where the interaction is basically van der Waals. So we thought that if we've gone so much, what if we could put some metal atoms inside this framework? Could we actually achieve stability? And in order to understand which metals we need to put in there, we examined quite a few. So let me just quickly overview some basics of covalent bonding. Imagine that you deal with two hydrogens or two heliums. Depending on the distance between them, you have a formation of molecular orbitals with some energy gain. But then the question is, how many electrons do we have? Ideally, we would like to populate all bonding states and not populate any antibonding states. So in the case of helium, yeah, you have too many electrons, so you have no chemical bonding. In the case of this group 4 elements, you have additional p orbitals. So as we know, you can construct hybrids by taking this s orbital and 1, 2, or 3 p orbitals. So in this way, you can increase the overlap and increase this delta. And for pz states, you have additional pi bonds that you could form. What is not quite widely known is that, in fact, this is really an idealization, because in real materials, you have a large separation between s and p states, about 7, 8 eV. So in fact, it takes some energy to create these hybrids in the first place. So for carbon, actually, it's a really nice starting model. And if you examine the density of states decomposed onto s, px, y, and pz states, then you see that indeed there is a sp2 character here. And obviously, there is pz bonding up here. And you have the Fermi level at this Dirac point. Well, things don't work like that for tin, because as you move down the periodic table, you actually decrease the strength of bond integrals. And there is not much hybridization going on between S and P levels. So here, a proper model would be to first consider the splitting of S levels. So you have bonding S levels and anti-bonding S levels. And these anti-bonding S levels are high enough in energy to hybridize with PXY. So then, indeed, you have additional splitting. And so there is a red and green character here, right? So in blue, I'm showing PZ states. And if you deal with a single sheet, then your Fermi level is close to this Dirac point. So what happens when you stack up these layers to form this AA stacking of tin? Well, these blue Dirac points shift a lot because you effectively form covalent bonds between layers. And that's how you gain a lot of energy. What is interesting is that there is this large valley in the DOS profile, which suggests that there are some unfilled bonding states. And it means that if you added some electrons into the system, you might stabilize this compound. So when we estimated how much charge is in this checkered area, it was exactly one electron per two tin atoms, which means that in the unit cell, you want to insert a monovalent metal. So if you do so, in this case, it's sodium. Sodium donates its electrons. And indeed, this depression in the DOS moves very close to the Fermi level. Well, as we discussed in the paper, it's not a rigid band model. So there are quite a few changes as you add sodium atoms in the band structure. So we decided to see which alkali metal would be most beneficial here. So this is formation energy as a function of the volume of the unit cell, fully relaxed. And in fact, for all alkali metals, we found the formation energy to be negative. But as I said, it's negative. It's good, but it's not a sufficient condition. So we had to examine further whether this particular phase is stable in the composition range of this particular alkali metal. What is interesting is that there is a huge increase in the volume as you go from potassium to rubidium. And it becomes clear why it happens when you look at the separation between the layers. So effectively, rubidium and cesium are so large that they break this covalent bond between the layers. In fact, the interlayer distance shrinks as a result of that. But we found that other phases in this rubidium tin and cesium tin systems are more stable, so this particular phase shouldn't form in this family of large alkali metal stannides. But for tin, we found that the phase is very close to stability. And in fact, we showed that compared to the known MS48 phase, HP3 phase stabilizes as a function of both temperature and pressure. So we think that its formation could be promoted by pressure. Just a few GPA should be sufficient. And then you will get a first compound that comprised of flat hexagonal sheets. Well, because of the strong covalent bonds between layers, it's unlikely that you will exfoliate it into individual stannin. That was our original goal. But when we examined the electronic structure, it turns out that this bulk material would have very interesting properties. Because when you turn on spin orbit coupling, you have this separation of bands into two groups. So it should have a topologically non-trivial behavior. And in fact, when I was contacted to give this talk, it was a standing prediction. But JAX has just been published. They did observe this sodium tin 2 phase synthesized at ambient condition and high temperatures. but they just saw the evidence of it. They didn't isolate a single phase. So we think that by applying pressure, you might actually be able to synthesize this particular compound. So while we were looking at sodium tin 2, we realized that a known barium tin 2 could be far more exciting. And this is really an unusual case because this compound was synthesized in 2008, and the paper has only been cited 4 times. And yet, these layers have this desired stannin-like morphology. It might exfoliate into stannin. And our colleague, Steve Young, examined the band structure and realized that it could be an overlooked strong topological insulator with a fairly large band gap of 200 MeV. So this is really remarkable. There is so much research into topological materials, and nobody seems to have looked at this one. So we immediately contacted a few groups. Can you synthesize or re-synthesize this compound? And the group of Paul Canfield at Ames tried it for a couple of months. They tried to synthesize single crystals. Well, the phase diagram is fairly complicated. And their conclusion was that, yes, it does form. So they have peaks corresponding to this compound. Unfortunately, it doesn't grow as a single crystal because the phase is buried under two compounds at nearby compositions. So obviously, I immediately checked whether this compound can be stabilized by pressure. And as opposed to the case of sodium tin 2, barium tin 2 is destabilized by both pressure and temperature. So it's a low temperature ambient pressure phase. And then it occurred to me that you might actually use this pressure to synthesize a single phase of this material. Because when I run my evolution researches, I found that Lavey phase at the same composition becomes stable at about 5 GPa. So what you might try to do is to start with elements, let's say barium and tin, at this composition, squeeze them at a few GPa, heat them up, and form this barium tin 2 phase. Then you take it down to ambient pressure and let it anneal. And because these phases are structurally related, as you can see here, there are layers. And all you need to do is just to move one atom from this middle portion to the layer, and then hopefully you'll get the desired hexagonal phase. So this would be an interesting way of using pressure, even though pressure itself doesn't stabilize your original compound. So I would really love to chat more about this possibility with groups here this afternoon. OK, so how much time do we have? OK, so perhaps I'll just give a quick overview on what is possible to predict from my point of view. So when it comes to prediction and characterization, you really need to see what information was actually taken from the experiment. Because in some cases, in fact, some phases were solved based on just XRD, which is really remarkable to me. You deal with powder XRD and you can still extract the crystal structure. In some cases, for light elements, you might not be able to pinpoint the atomic positions, but then you can just run a simple DFT. It's not really a prediction, it's barely, characterization is just a refinement of your experimental structure. But in some cases, you cannot really solve your atomic positions at all, but you can extract the unit cell size. And it turns out to be absolutely critical for structure search. Because compared to the fully unconstrained optimization, it takes a fraction of time to determine the structure if you already know the unit cell. In the case of this 28 atom calcium B6 case, I could find the ground state in 200 optimizations instead of 10,000. So it really speeds up the search. And in fact, if you look through the literature, a lot of notable examples relied on this experimental data. Well, in our case, I still don't consider calcium B6 as a validated prediction because we didn't know about this phase at the time of the experiment. But we didn't use any parameter input in our search. So it was sort of an identification of a new ground state. Yeah, but there are a few examples where we didn't know anything about the structure, for example, iron B4 and so on. So again, these are just a select examples. It's not a very recent table, so maybe there are more examples now. In fact, right now we're writing up results where we identify the structure with 56 atoms without any experimental input. So that's quite an exciting development. So yes, with that, I don't think I will have time to discuss the acceleration with neural nets. Let me just summarize that indeed, if you want to predict the structure, you just need to use every method available, because there is no single strategy that you can take you to the ground state. We've shown that evolution research does have advantages when you deal with large systems. So in terms of validated predictions that I've shown today, calcium B6 has an unusually large unit cell with an exotic boron framework. And we show that it actually remains metastable when you release the pressure. In case of iron B4, we've had both compound and structure confirmed. And what was really unexpected for us is that indeed it's a phono-mediated superconductor. I've talked to many people in the field, and I always ask, can you give an example of a superconductor that was actually predicted from scratch? And that seemed to be one of the first. The only two examples go back to 1990s, lithium under pressure and silicon under pressure. But since our work, for example, this H3S was predicted experimentally, that was very impressive. So in terms of standing predictions that I hope some groups will try, there is a sodium TIN2 that should form at a few GPA and to have interesting topological features, and especially barium TIN2. There is this unconventional two-stage synthesis route, possibly. So if you form it, I'm pretty sure there will be groups lined up to get your sample from you to work, because it's supposed to be a strong topological insulator. Yes, and recently we've been working on accelerating the search, because it takes actually millions of CPU hours. And for metallic systems, we've been able to accelerate the search by a factor of 1,000 to 10,000. So that's quite exciting. And obviously, this work has involved a lot of people. I would like to thank my students, Shina Shah at Oxford, and my students at Binghamton, and a lot of experimental groups that have been brave enough to try our predictions. And with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention and take questions. We don't. We started with it, and we assume that there are no other compounds that formed, but we never checked it. Right. Right. So we think it's still a phase of calcium B6, and the reason for that. Because as you see, we start with this 1-0-0 peak, and it looks to be a related set of peaks. It's a split, so we just couldn't nail that phase. But it's a good question. I just mentioned that, in fact, if you manage to change the composition just a little bit, there is another phase that is more stable at calcium B6.25 composition. Right, so if I had half an hour, I would show you our work on lithium boron, and that was a nightmare. We actually had to develop some markers to understand the change in composition as we increased pressure. And in fact, that was the additional evidence that we properly modeled the material, and that was the indication that the phase that we were after actually formed. But in general, I would like to hear your input.
differences between your evolutionary search and other ones? How big a piece of the topological insulator would someone need to show that it's a topological insulator?
Good question. I actually asked this question before. I've asked that probably you would be if you can synthesize it in a multi-envelope cell, definitely.
On?
Oh.
Well, that might be. Oh.
Structure in the binary.
Our original motivation was to get an isolated sheet of stannin, but in this case, it would display interesting properties in the bulk form. Well, in fact, since it's a topologically interesting compound, interesting things would be happening on the surface. So Steve Young actually did a lot of calculations, slab calculations, to simulate how the topological properties are affected by what's going on the surface. So we put different elements and just saw how this Dirac point moves up and down. So it wouldn't be trivial to examine it, but again, if you have this starting material, I think a lot of groups would be interested.
Of course,
this
microphone doesn't work.
Right.
Yeah, so the question is,
right. Well, our referees actually said that we should amend our statement. Magnesium diboride has a record. You see, well, we modified that statement. It's a ambient pressure phonon-mediated record. So, in my opinion, magnesium diboride is just a freak of nature. It just happens to be properly hole-doped to have this high TC. I've spent 10 years looking for such examples, and lithium boron that I showed or mentioned today seems to be the closest one, and still the TC, estimated TC there would be about 10-15 Kelvin. So I've asked this question every person in the field I've met, and nobody knows. The idea is that it's very difficult to come up with a predictor. You cannot really investigate superconducting properties for a range of materials. You need really to know the structure. And if in other fields, like catalysis, you can come up with a descriptor, here nothing has really worked. I can show you one example for layered metal borides where we associated phonon softening with a TC, but that's a really specific descriptor. Oh, I would be very interested.
If not, please join us for lunch. Thank you one more time.
Right. Well, in fact, I visit a group of Hardy Gross.